So I've now been using the M1 MacBook Air and MacBook Pro for 2 weeks, and I wanted to give a bit of an update on what it's like to live with M1 Max because, quite honestly, they are astonishing. And going back to Intel gets harder every single day. So today we're going to talk about not just the performance and benchmarks of these machines, but what it's like to actually live with Apple Silicon. Today's video is sponsored by my friends over at iFixit. Just in time for the holiday season, they're offering new mini driver kits, the Minnow and the Moray. Both come in at under $20 and are backed by a lifetime warranty, so they're perfect stocking stuffers for the fixers in your family. Plus, if you use code FIXSHIP by December 12th, you can get free shipping on all orders over $50. I love these little kits because even the smallest one comes with Phillips 000, Pentalobe, Torx, and even tri-wing screws for unibody MacBook battery replacements. I could fully disassemble almost any MacBook just with this tiny screwdriver kit. In fact, I think these new iFixit kits are so good, we should use them to check out the cooling systems in the new MacBooks. Both bottom plates are held on with a couple of Pentalobe P5 screws. And then with that, the MacBook Air's bottom cover simply pops off, revealing the internals are not much changed over the previous models, except for a now larger aluminum heatsink that replaces the fan. The MacBook Pro is a little more annoying to get inside. We have to pry up the bottom case and then pop a few clips along the side, and then the bottom case slides off. Inside, it's not a lot to look at. It's very similar to the previous 2020 MacBook Pro with this big round thing over here. It says here in my notes that this is called a fan. That's weird. I've never heard it before. Honestly, we spend a lot of time here talking about benchmarks, performance, video editing, rendering, all of that sort of stuff, which is very important and really interesting to talk about, but it's not something that I do every waking moment of every single day. What I do is browse the internet, type up documents, text my friends with iMessage, and those are the tasks where Apple Silicon really shines. It's impossible not to notice how much quieter, cooler, and longer lasting these Macs are. Even if the performance were exactly the same as the Intel MacBook Air and Pro, these would be better. Every day, I am absolutely astounded by the thermal performance and how cool these things run. When I made my initial videos talking about the M1 Max, we didn't have any tools for monitoring the temperatures inside the machines, but now we do. There's a couple of tools that are available, and the results are amazing. For starters, just opening up the Air and letting it sit on the desktop next to an Intel MacBook doing the same thing is mind-blowing. I let both computers sit in sleep mode for an hour to completely equalize in temperature, and when I open the lids, they both start at 24 degrees Celsius. After 10 minutes sitting on the desktop, the MacBook Air was at 26 degrees, and the MacBook Pro was at 44. And that's before you even do anything. Then I pulled up one of my YouTube videos, 15 minutes, 4K playback, full brightness on both screens. At the end of the test, the MacBook Pro was sitting at 63 degrees and had burned through 8% of its battery. The Air was sitting at 36 degrees and had burned through just 4% of its battery. This is the kind of thing that you will notice every single day, no matter what you're doing. If you're the type of person who likes to use a MacBook while you're sitting in bed or on the couch with a blanket on, then you know that an Intel MacBook will get really hot and uncomfortable, and you'll have to like weirdly prop it up and try to let the vent go. That is no longer an issue with Apple Silicon. Even on the MacBook Pro, which has a fan, you can block the vents all you want and it will not overheat. I mean, unless you cover up all the vents with tape and start running Cinebench. In terms of battery life, both of these things will go for hours, but the MacBook Pro is particularly astounding. One morning, for 2.5 hours, I was typing up scripts, browsing through Twitter and just sort of light web tasks like that, and I used less than 10% of the battery. It went from 100 to like 93 in 2.5 hours. That is amazing, and frankly, it's embarrassing for Intel. Even their best cannot get this sort of efficiency and power. But the really humiliating test for Intel was Cinebench. I whipped out the 2020 Intel MacBook Pro as well as both M1 MacBooks, let them idle on the desktop for about 20 minutes, and then ran the Cinebench R23 10-minute test. Straight away, the MacBook Pro jumps up to 50 degrees just by opening Cinebench. And as soon as the test begins, you start to see how rapidly the temperatures climb. Within seconds, we're hitting 90 degrees, while the M1 Macs are still in the low 30s. Once we get to the maximum heat saturation of all of these devices, the Intel machine sits at 95 degrees Celsius, the fanless MacBook Air at 83, and the Pro at 78. That's nuts. For the longest time, Apple has been a complete joke as it pertains to thermal management. In 2018, the Core i9 MacBook Pro literally became a meme because of how hot it gets. But in the last 2 years, they went from the $3,000 overheating Core i9 MacBook to literally the coolest running chips I have ever tested in any laptop, and they outperform that $3,000 MacBook at a third of the price. If you're still on the fence about whether Apple Silicon is impressive or not, then you need to go and buy some eyes. All right, so here is the biggest caveat people talk about when discussing the M1 Max, and that is compatibility. Now, I'm by no means an intense niche pro user, and these Apple Silicon Macs aren't fulfilling the same task as, say, my 18-core iMac Pro that I use for editing. But that being said, I have so far found app compatibility to be tremendously good. After installing Rosetta 2, I can barely even tell that I'm running apps in translation. They just work. I installed Steam and found that Rise of the Tomb Raider works perfectly well through Rosetta. Sure, you might not want to play through the whole game on this thing, but it's better than on any Intel integrated chip I've ever tried. I was also able to get some Windows apps installed with Crossover. The Windows desktop version of Among Us installed and worked completely flawlessly. I even ran Star Wars Battlefront 2. Kinda. And you might say, well, sure, maybe these applications run when they're translated, but aren't they going to run a lot slower since you're going through a translation layer? Well, the thing is, because the M1 is so powerful for machines of this category, even when hampered by a translation layer, they still run better than on the previous Intel MacBooks, and you still get better battery life. Now, yes, the more niche your use case is, the more likely you are to run into compatibility problems, but then again, that's why Apple started with the Air and the 13-inch Pro. They're the most mass-market machines and are more likely to be bought by casual users who won't run into those sorts of issues. This gives developers more time to get stuff working before pros start making the switch. But that's not to say that there aren't pros out there that couldn't use these Apple Silicon MacBooks. I lent the M1 MacBook Air to longtime friend of the channel Noah Rubin, who is a professional software developer, and I told him to put it through its paces. Noah was amazed to find that in all of the software development benchmarks he put it through, the M1 MacBook Air absolutely crushed his 2018 Core i9 MacBook Pro. In Xcode, it compiled a couple of tools in 7 minutes and 3 seconds compared to 11 minutes and 43 seconds on the MacBook Pro, and when using CreateML to train a neural network, the Air annihilated the MacBook Pro. It took 1 hour and 20 minutes, while the Pro took 2 hours and 34 minutes. Not to mention the fans were going quite a bit. Noah is hard at work right now on a number of videos talking about what Apple Silicon means for developers and how good they are for software development. So definitely make sure to go ahead and subscribe to his channel with the link in the description below. You won't want to miss it. It really is amazing how new and different these computers feel, given that Apple didn't change their designs at all from the Intel versions that came out earlier this year. But I do want to stress that just because they're amazing doesn't mean you have to go and buy one. Most of the amazing feats we talked about today are not going to be exclusive to M1 Max. The battery life, efficiency, and thermal management are likely going to be a staple of all Apple Silicon machines, and the compatibility is only going to improve as time goes on. I think it's really important to acknowledge how impressive these machines are, but you shouldn't necessarily trade down to get one. If you have a 16-inch MacBook Pro or a 27-inch iMac, your takeaway from looking at these devices should be, I can't wait to see what this is going to mean in the machines that fit my use case, not, okay, maybe I could get away with using a base model MacBook Air instead of a 10-core iMac Pro. It's going to be really, really exciting to see the benefits of the M1 Max applied to a broader range of Apple products, and I have to say, after living with Apple Silicon for just a few weeks, there's no going back. Thank you guys so much for watching this video. These things are absolutely unbelievable. I know it sounds like I'm being hyperbolic when I say things like, there's no going back, or oh, it's the best computer ever, but I'm being serious. There is no hyperbole when I say that they are the coolest running Macs I've ever used, the coolest running laptops I've ever used. It's unbelievable, and I can't wait to see what's next. So if you liked this video, make sure to leave a like down below. Don't forget to subscribe, and definitely consider following me on Twitter at Luke Miani, and check out my subreddit and my Twitch channel, which you'll find in the description below. And with that, I'll see you all in the next video.